What made you get an idea to write a book called Class Warfare?
I had decided to go back into doing some magazine journalism a couple of years ago and had heard something. I've always been interested in education and the unions and public education in particular, and had heard something about this thing called the rubber room. And what the rubber room was a place where that rare breed of New York City school teacher, the rare school teacher who was deemed to be so incompetent or so abusive that the city was going to try to fire them despite the tenure rules, they'd put these teachers in these so-called temporary reassignment centers to decide whether a teacher, for example, who hadn't done any lesson plans, hadn't assigned any homework, hadn't graded any papers, hadn't given any grades, there was nothing on her blackboard or her bulletin boards in her classroom in Brooklyn, whether she, after repeated warnings, whether she shouldn't be removed. And her one of her defenses in this endless arbitration hearing was whether she had had custody over her teacher's manual. The defense by her lawyer, paid for by the union, was that if she didn't have custody of her teacher's manual, how was she supposed to know that she was supposed to give homework or give grades or give report cards
or
put stuff on the bulletin board or do anything? I mean, how are you supposed to know you're supposed to do that stuff? So they argued for half a day over, sort of like the O.J. Simpson trial over the custody of the gloves or whatever it was. Had she ever gotten the teacher's manual? This was just so bizarre that I came to believe it was the tip of a much, much larger proverbial iceberg.
Now, some of the pushback along the lines of the anecdotes you give is that you're finding really unusual examples, like maybe a particular teacher in this particular rubber room.
Well, what's not an outlier is the fact that by any standard, our public schools are in major urban areas and in not so major urban areas are failing. We lag not simply behind, the usual suspects, Singapore and China and Korea, but we lag behind Estonia. I mean, we are just nowhere, and we're going nowhere, and we spend 2, 3, 4 times as much money per student for terrible results. And the fact is, what makes this really sad and to many people infuriating is that it doesn't have to be that way, because there are now effective charter schools that prove that with the same community, the same kids, that you can get many of them, if not most of them, to succeed.
One of the many reasons people say you're a hypocrite is that the story of Jessica Reed, the teacher who you profile in the book, she had worked in a charter school, and at the end of the book you say, turns out she decided to go to a district school after all, for her own personal reasons. What is your response to the claim that that undermines the message of the book in general?
Well, it hardly makes me a hypocrite. There are 3.2 million teachers in the United States. I chose to put her in the book. If I was so worried about being exposed as a hypocrite, I could have picked any of the other 3.2 million teachers to portray in the book. I certainly interviewed a lot more than Jessica Reed. I thought her story was really important precisely because of the way she ended up. I mean, I didn't start to write the book until I knew how she was ending up. It wasn't like the book suddenly took a turn on me when I was halfway through writing it. It took a turn on me when I was 3/4 of the way through reporting it. But the goal and the work of an honest journalist is to write what you see.
One of my favorite things to do is have people respond to their critics. When my film came out, it was one of my favorite things to do with my critics. So we have The New York Times writing, Brill wants us to believe that unions are the primary, even sole cause of failing public schools, but hard evidence for this is scarce.
The unions have acted as trade unions, not as associations of professionals, and they've done a terrific job protecting the rank and file. And when a union does a really good job at that, it protects the lowest common denominator of the rank and file. So therefore, there's no distinction by performance, and the lowest performer gets all the protections that the highest performer gets. By the same token, the highest performer gets the same degree of recognition and praise and money that the lowest performer gets, which is not very much at all. And that is not, the unions aren't the cause of the failure of American public education, but their contracts are an obstacle to improving American public education, but in some places, as I write in the book, the unions are actually now becoming part of the solution, not part of the problem. And I think more of them can be and more of them will be.
And that's an interesting point. One of the internecine battles within the ed reform movement has to do with whether unions can be reformed or they need to be circumvented completely. Terry Moe, the Stanford professor in his book, maintains that other position, that really they are until, these aren't his words exactly, but until a scorpion becomes a frog, as long as their interests are protecting the workers, then the children will never be placed before that. And what's more, they're more about protecting the older teachers than the younger teachers in any policy decision that might...
He's certainly right about that. But okay. but what I think he's wrong about, and it may be just a matter of interpretation, or maybe you've misinterpreted him, but I doubt it, is that I think that unions can become part of the solution if they more accurately reflect the wishes of their teachers. One of the things I take a lot of care to say in this book and that I found in my reporting is the teachers' unions, the union leadership, doesn't really reflect the wishes and the goals of most teachers. Most teachers, if you ask them, would like to be recognized and advanced in their careers based on their performance, not how long they've been breathing. And most of the good teachers certainly would like that kind of system where the contract and the workplace is about performance, not about protection.
But if there were a reform that would help teaching in general, but not be great for the older teachers, would you expect the union?
Well, that actually goes to what I was about to say, which is if you look at the votes in union elections, you know, for president of a local union, the turnout is very low because most teachers are disaffected from their union. They sort of like the protection. In most cases, they don't have any choice. They have to join the union. Turnout's very low. And the people who do vote are the older teachers, or in the case of New York City, where the turnout might be 20%, half of those people who vote are actually retired teachers. They're not even teachers in the classroom. And they're worried about one thing and one thing only, and that is the continuation, if not the expansion, of their pension benefits and their health care benefits, which continue for them and their families for their lifetimes after they've retired. And they don't want to lose that. I don't blame them. But that doesn't reflect the goals or the worldview of a 26 or 27 or 34-year-old teacher who went into teaching for all the right reasons and can be very effective but becomes disaffected when they realize that this is not a place for high achievers.
I loved your Diane Ravitch interview on C-SPAN. It was, I think, almost some sort of milestone in the discussion on ed reform. Talk about that interview.
Some people say it was a little more exciting than the typical C-SPAN fare. I was asked by C-SPAN to come on and talk about the book, and then they said, well, you need to know that the person we have chosen to interview you is Diane Ravitch, and the publicity people at Simon & Schuster were all worried about that.
Worried.
And I said, that's great. I think what could be better? And it was fun.
Now that I've officially thrown my notes away, anything surprise you when you came out with the book? Any reaction surprise you?
I mean, I made the mistake that I'm sure you make of having a Google alert for myself. So I have now probably read 20 or 30 book reviews that start with the following sentence. I haven't read Stephen Brill's book, Class Warfare. I don't intend to read it, but here's what I'm told it says, and here's why it's just a lot of junk. You know, something to that effect.
I did have that with my film. People who had not seen the film,
I haven't
and they
seen
were
the
blogging
film,
about
it.
But
it sucks. It's terrible.
Yeah.
Right? You know, that's a little disheartening. But on the other hand, the kind of mail and calls and emails I've gotten, you know, from parents, from teachers, lots of teachers saying, you know, thank you for writing this book. That's good.